Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this review of the Meinuo M8813 Precision Power Supply and Programmable Power Supply. Now first of all, I have to give a big thanks to Frankie, who kindly shipped this over from Hong Kong to me. I bought it off him, but he went through the rigmarole of arranging it and getting it for me and got it shipped here very swiftly. So big thanks to Frankie. Now, I acquired this power supply because, for one, I was keen to have a programmable power supply. In my testing with energy sources, I wanted to be able to program a power supply to charge a battery in my own way, because you can obviously set charging profiles, send it to this, and it can obviously outsource a current and a voltage. Now, the current and the voltage on this one, the voltage goes up to 150 volts, but only at 1 amp. That was a particular model that I selected because I wanted a higher voltage range, because I had nothing which could produce a voltage range that high. There are many other models in the lineup, which I'm going to show you when we get down to the bench, which provide perhaps a smaller voltage range but far higher current, and some in between, which give you actually quite a reasonably high voltage range and high current. The other beauty about Meinuo is, or this particular range of power supplies, is that they supply a fairly precise reading that you can dial in. There are some limitations to that. I'm going to show you that when we get to the bench. I'll also try, if there's time, I'm going to try and give you a brief overview of the software that you can use to program this. So let's get down to the bench. Right, so let's tell you a little about kind of the physical characteristics of this beast, the other models in the lineup, and then its basic capabilities. So on the front here, you'll see it's obviously got all the buttons where you can actually directly input either a current or a voltage setting. It is a 5.5-digit voltmeter and ohmmeter, so it can do 4-wire measurements of resistance up to 10 ohms, so it's a milliohm meter. So it's not a feature I've tried, and we'll try that in this review. So the input for the actual voltage measurement goes into the top here. The bottom is the output, and obviously your 4-wire measurement for resistance goes into the 4 outputs, and you've got a separate ground on the side here. You've got this knob, which I'm going to demonstrate, where you can actually change the values of your settings, and if you hear, it's got a slight push in to actually change and select various digits. I've got a slight issue with that, but I'm going to demonstrate that when I show you the actual workings. As you can see, this is the M8813 150 volt 1 amp. It says DC source meter. Now, the one thing I'm going to demonstrate here is that don't be alluded to the fact that you can perhaps use this as a reference for like calibrating something. So I thought that might be a possibility, but the output, the actual output setting, is a little noisy if you want to really accurate reference, because this goes down to obviously 5 places, and you're certainly not going to get 5 place accuracy without noise on this device. But again, I'll demonstrate that. Anyway, let's spin it around and have a look at the back. Well, before we get to the back, here's a side view. It's obviously got the stand in the front, which can be flipped underneath, so it's flat. You can actually stack a few on top of each other, or have it lying flat, or flip it to the top, or obviously carry it. Then at the back here, you can see it's got a fan. It's not very noisy. It only powers up the fan once you're actually pulling a fair amount of current, or let's say power, from it. So a combination of voltage and current. It's obviously got the mains input. You can switch between 110 and 220 volts. It's got a fuse in there, which you need to change accordingly. It's got a COM port over here, because you can remotely control this and get output from it on a PC. And then it has these inputs or outputs over here. So you've got a remote sense. You've got over here, you can see you've got minus S, plus S. So if you are measuring currents, reasonably high currents, and you want your voltage measurement to be a bit more accurate, you've got a remote sense input over here. You've got a TRQ and a TRI, so you've got a trigger output. So when this is going, stepping through, let's say, a list which you provide it with, you can set triggers, and it's got an input output over here, both the TRQ and the TRI. The TRI trigger is something you can actually use to remotely enable or remotely switch on and off the output of the device as well, or lock, being able to switch it on and off, and then you've got a ground. Right, so I'm going to power it up and go through a very quick self-test, and then it's kind of ready to use. Now, what I'll just quickly show you is some of the information that comes inside the manual. What does come with the device is it does come with a kind of set of very basic set of leads. Not the best quality, but certainly usable. Mine did come with the communication port, a serial to USB. I'm not sure, and you'd need to check with, because I know sometimes sellers sell these with that as an option. So I think it is an additional option you need to purchase with this. It doesn't come by default. It does come with a manual, but the manual is in Chinese, but Manuo's site does have a perfectly readable English manual as well, and then obviously the software that comes with the actual cable. Right, I'm not going to spend too long kind of showing what is in the manual, and if you want to kind of stop and read what it says here, then by all means obviously pause the video. But just to note, it kind of notes that it's got low ripple and noise, high resolution accuracy, 0.1 of a millivolt to 0.01 milliamp, and the M8831 version reaches up to 0.001 milliamp, which are quite incredible specs. But I say, we'll have a look at that. Built-in high accuracy 5.5-digit voltmeter and milliometer. Obviously, it's got a VFD display. It's got the fan. It talks here about remote voltage compensation, which is that remote sense, and multi-data storage. Now, don't be fooled by this. I was thinking that it might have some internal data storage. It doesn't. I'm assuming what it can do, it can store certain startup configurations internally. But otherwise, other data storage is done remotely through the cable to a PC. External trigger input and output, as I noted on the back. So this is something where, like for instance, I've got the Manuo electronic DC load, and I want to actually have these talk to each other to cycle batteries and what have you. So that's where that trigger could be quite helpful. Power on, it says software calibration, rack mountable, and then obviously the interface. Now again, quickly, I'm just going to show you the actual models which are noted here. It's got a list of the models and the outputs here. So you can see you've got from the M8811, which is 0 to 30 volts, 5 amp. The 12 is to 75 and 2 amp. That's quite a nice range. You've got to the 150, which I've got, to 1 amp, and then a 30 volt 1 amp. And it obviously gives all the various specifications here. And the interesting here is the where it says setting value accuracy voltage, and it says 0.01% plus 2 millivolt. Or on my, yeah, on my one, it's 0.01% plus 10 millivolt. So certainly some good accuracy quotes what it's saying, and then the read back, it's saying 0.02. But again, there's something here I'm going to show you, particularly with the current settings, in terms of what you actually set and what you read back. And then just something to note, the weight of it, 6.5 kilograms. That is the lightest one of the pack, and that's my one, and there's a fair bit of heft in that 6.5 kilograms. You then go on to get the 0 to 6 volt 60 amp version, 30 volt 20 amp, 75 8 amp. You start going up to 28 kilograms for those units. And then we've got the 15 to 60 amp, 30 to 30 volt and 35 amp. 75 volt, 15 amp, 100 volt, 11 amps, so some quite beefy units, and there you're setting up to 45 kilograms for the unit weight. Right, the first thing we'll test, and I'll just quickly show you, is on the actual meter itself. As you can see, you get four lines of display. The first top one over here is the one that is the measurement of the output. Then the one down here I'm pointing to is what you're actually setting to. So you set this, but sometimes you don't necessarily get out what you've actually set. So it's got those two different displays, and then obviously you're setting a voltage, and it'll show you the current as well. It shows you the status of the output, which is currently off. That just disappears when the output is on. And then this is your 5.5-digit voltmeter over here. Now we've got, obviously, because we're at a higher voltage level, we've only got to, I say only, it's not bad, we've got down to 4 digits. And I've got my amp probe here measuring my precise 5 volt reference, which is, and I can tell you now, my amp probe is flickering on the 1 digit here because it is slightly out of the temperature in the lab. It should be reading precisely 5 volts exactly to 4 places. I'm very confident with the reference I've got. And as you can see, the menuo, a bit of flutter on that last digit, but certainly it is well within its quoted spec. It's only a few digits out in terms of that reading. Right, and just to demonstrate its resistance measuring capability, I do have a set of Kelvin clips connected to a decade resistor box that I have. To go and measure milliohms, what you do, or say up to 10 ohms, you just go, it's a shift function, you'll see the shift function comes on the display, and then under the key, on the keypad here, it says volt/milliohm. So you go and push that, and you'll then see it actually starts taking a milliohm reading. I currently have my decade resistance box set to 700 milliohms, so certainly the reading is not far off, barring certainly some inaccuracies more likely in my box. If I go and change that to 6, 5, 4, so it certainly does very low and accurate measurements, but of course you do need a set of Kelvin clips which don't come with the device itself. Right, and before we kind of go on to its sourcing capability, just the last bit on the measurement capability that caught my eye, and I don't quite understand. I've got one of Doug's references on here which is producing under 0.5 volt. It's 0.25 volt. And the reason I did that was because I expected to see the higher resolution. Often with when you got a meter that quotes 5.5 digits, at 1 volt that might be a 100,000 count, and then obviously once you go over 1 volt, it drops down. But I've come below 1 volt and we still only have 4.5 digits in effect. So I'm a little mystified. I have gone and read the manual and looked at the settings, and that I don't understand. If I do find an answer to that, I'll annotate, or if someone else is aware and I'm missing something, then certainly do point it out. One last thing about aesthetics before we do get stuck into it. It's obviously got this rubber kind of protection around the front. If you're stacking it, that can easily be removed if you want to kind of enhance or give it a better look on your bench, as opposed to having that sat on it, which might cover, well, it doesn't really cover up anything, but it might be an aesthetic that you prefer. Right, the meter does also have a menu system where you can set up the configuration and the setup of the meter. You've got these arrows on the side here where you've got a system set and a config. In the config, you can initialize the meter, so it resets it to factory defaults. Out memory, to tell you, I'm not sure. The try setting, that's the setting at the back, the trigger input. You can configure it for what it does in terms of off and on. It's got a fast recall. Key sound, by default the key sound is on. I'm going to just demonstrate that to you, because the last thing I think you want is that, so that's why I leave it off. You can obviously lock the knob. You can enable the remote sense. You can set the current unit to be either amps or milliamps, as you can see on the display there. So you can decide, and you can see the resolution you've got there on the actual amps. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You certainly have 5 there, but I say it does say 5.5 dVm, as in digital voltmeter, which I say I'm still mystified about. Right, then you've got match power. You can set the frequency, and why on earth, when I was playing, I must have changed it earlier, so I'll set it to 60 hertz. And then you've got the communications set up for the actual port. If we exit that, you've then got the system set. You can go set a maximum voltage. So if you are testing devices, sensitive devices, you may be concerned about accidentally hitting 150 volts and the blue smoke may appear. So you can certainly limit the maximum voltage, which is very handy. You can also step voltage. Now I explain here. you can go and set the voltage by twiddling this knob over here and pushing it to set a digit. And I'm going to show you that there's a potential issue with doing that, because you could mistakenly, while you're turning this, push it, jump to a higher digit, which is the default direction it moves, and suddenly be increasing by tenfold what you wanted to increase. So you can also set the voltage on these arrows over here, and that is what that refers to, the resolution that you're setting on these arrows. And then you get the exit of the actual setup. Right, so now that we're actually on the meter itself, let's test its output and how well it works. Right, so in terms of operating this as a precision power supply, what I've got a kind of 12 volt LED strip, some very bright LEDs down here connected to the output. Now, you've obviously got the option of either setting, you've got a V set and an I set. So I can off the bat go and say, right, I want to set the output voltage to, let's say, 8 volts. So I just push 8 and push enter. And you can see it gives me the voltage to 4 places. I could, if I was really being fussy, saying I want 9, if I go V set, I could say I want 9.001 volts. Enter, and as you can see, it goes and sets it to that. You can also go and make the changes, and while you've got the live output with this knob over here, and you can see there's a little flashing cursor under the digit that you can actually set. So I'm setting that second digit after the decimal at the moment. If I push the knob, it moves to the next one. I can change that, push the knob, it goes there. And that's where I say you need to be careful, because you can obviously, it's handy if you're testing something, you're going to actually change the actual value, potentially be changing the value with this knob. Now you could be sitting over here on that second one, just thinking you're changing a tenth of a volt, and as you push this, you can see it's gone and slipped because I pushed too hard, and then suddenly I'm dialing up and you get a mistake, or you make a mistake. So there is where these arrows are quite handy. Now as you saw, I've got it set to change the second decimal place. So if you are working on something sensitive and concerned about using that dial, but you have to go into the settings and then obviously go and change that. It would have been nice perhaps if you could actually set the digit you wanted to move, you wanted to change, and then actually do the setting over here. But nonetheless, that's the way they've got it set up. So right, so I'm going to dial in a safe voltage of, let's say, 9 volts. So I go V-set, 9, and then enter. And then I just switch on the on-off, which enables the output. And as you can see, I've got the LEDs which are powered on under here. So they're fairly bright. I can then obviously down here go and dial them down and dial them up. And this is where this device does give you a lot of granularity in terms of making fine adjustments. Now remember, the first display here is actually showing the setting, and then you've got your actual output over here. Now, just now I'm going to put a meter on it, but we'll see that sometimes doesn't exactly tie up to what the voltmeter might be showing. So I think there is some disparity over there, but you've got to note that what you're necessarily setting, that's the kind of closer reading to the actual output. So you can obviously dial down, you've got this fine setting, and because you've got that kind of fine setting, I mean, if we go down to, let's say, millivolts, although when I make the adjustment here, and this is something I want you to note, just note the reading in the display over there. So to the millivolt, if I adjust down, you can see it didn't adjust a millivolt down there. If I go down there, okay, it's dropped one now, it's twittering around. While I make fine adjustments, you can see it's not exactly correlating on the output there and giving you what you're adjusting over here. If we step up to the second decimal place, there you get something closer to what you're actually setting. So that's what I just want to also highlight. Although it is a precision power supply and you've got some fairly fine settings, it's only down at this level you're kind of really getting that correlation. You still have the ability to make fine settings down here, really fine settings, but don't expect to get the kind of actual read output accuracy. So down here, if I kind of wind this down, You can see on the actual LEDs, they're dimming very, 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 very slowly. So you do have fine adjustment. So if you have a circuit and you're kind of trying to adjust a voltage down, you do have very fine adjustment, but not to the precision of actually setting a digit, certainly not down to millivolts anyway. And you can take this right down and we can take it up, push it if we want to dial up faster. And as you can see, the LEDs, these are really bright LEDs. I mean, if I dial this up here, go a little bit quicker, these are 12 volts. And if I take them up to 12 volts, you can see how bright they are. You can see I've got that. So you've certainly got, compared to, let's say, any of the other power supplies I had, you just wouldn't have that level of fine adjustment, which is absolutely great, that you can actually go and specify and at least down to the second digit, make that adjustment. And if you go right down to the fourth digit, you are certainly making adjustments and very fine adjustments, but just don't expect the digits to be exactly right. Right, so that's obviously the voltage adjustment. Now what I'm going to do, and obviously it's controlling the voltage, it's got a voltage control over here. If we now go and set the current, I can now go switch off the output. I'm going to go actually do a VSET, set this to 12 volts, which is kind of its operating voltage. Right, and if I now want to kind of set a current limit, I then obviously just go to ISET. I push the ISET. I can say that I want 0.001 amp or 1 milliamp and push enter. It comes up with this display. I can then push the on the output button, and as you can see, our LEDs are switched on, and it shows you that we happen to be, because I'm limiting the current, you can see the CC there because I'm limiting the current, it can't get up to the actual voltage that we've actually set. Now by default it's sitting on the voltage setting there, but if I, while the output is live, push ISET, I can then go and play around with the current. So again, I just push the control, I'm getting to the milliamp setting, and I can then slowly adjust up the current. And as I adjust it up, you can actually see the lights, they're fairly sensitive to the current adjustment here. And again, on many other power supplies, to have this amount of fine adjustment on the current setting, you just wouldn't normally have it. So as you can see, I can adjust up here. It's actually showing the current output, and I can take it up to a point where you can see now the voltage, it's switched over to control voltage because it's drawing its maximum current. But certainly it does allow you a lot of fine adjustment, and obviously you can go and dial in that exact current control on the keypad, which is far more accurate than a normal power supply merely trying to very finely adjust for trying to hit the right milliamp. And here you've got a lot of control, because of course I can go and control a digit lower and do really fine adjustments that way, and another digit lower. So it certainly does allow you a lot of precision that way. But let's connect a voltmeter and just see how well that adjustment does work. Right, so now what I've done, I've got my amp probe sat in here, set on the milliamp reading, and it goes down to three places for milliamp. I've got the current output currently set to zero, and I'm going to adjust the milliamp setting on the actual output itself. So if I click up there, you can actually see on the amp probe, it's actually showing to that milliamp, that's what it seems to be measuring. And the actual measurement in this case seems to be following not far behind. So it certainly seems to do fairly well in that regard. As you can see, I can adjust up 10 milliamp. It's showing just shy of, or just below over there. It's certainly not far off. As I dial that up, let's go to something random. Well, at the moment, it's obviously now, even though I've got set 61 milliamp, it's showing it's outputting 50, and that's also what the actual amp probe is showing itself. And as you can see, I've got that level of adjustment. Let's just see if I do go down to the fourth digit. Look at that. Okay, so as you can see, that's quite impressive. the moment. Adjusting down to the fourth digit. And certainly what the AND probe is showing seems to verify that it's certainly following even that fine measurement. So I must say, I'm fairly impressed with that. But now what I want to do is the same for the voltage to see how it tracks with the voltage. Alright, so here we go. This time we're measuring the voltage because I just want to compare the output over here. Now, as you can see, the AND probe is measuring fairly closely. It's a few counts out on the representation over here. We'll dial things up a bit to just kind of a random input. So I've got 9.47. It's got 9.46 over here. Okay, now it's certainly far closer to the actual reading on the AND probe. And there could be certainly a little bit of voltage drop in the cables coming to where I'm measuring. So, certainly not too bad. Let's just dial it up to another random figure. So I've got 11.67 on the display. We've got 11.667, 11.666. Five, just a little twitch on the digit over there. I do have an extra digit actually on the AND probe just for fun, just to put it in there. We'll go up a little bit higher. Don't want to go too high because I'll blow the LEDs. But certainly not tracking too far. Now, so the one thing I wanted to be aware about in terms of, because I'm making changes on the second digit over here, that's represented fairly easily. If I start making, let's say, changes on the millivolts over here, if I start stepping up, you're not necessarily going to see those changes represented over here. And certainly once you start making changes down on the fourth digit over there, it's not, you're not going to correlate that with what you're getting out on the actual meter. So that is just something I wanted to highlight. I think it would be perhaps a little extreme, obviously expecting those kind of changes down there, that you can make really, really fine changes and expect them at the actual output, but that you're not going to get. Once you start kind of getting to the third digit, again, when you start making the changes, you'll note that it doesn't correlate over here. It'll then suddenly jump. Sometimes I've noted. But certainly once you get to the second digit, then you start getting to a point where you can reasonably expect what you're putting in over here to correlate up here. Obviously, as long as you haven't got any current control or current limiting or what have you have going on. Right, so I'll give you a quick brief overview of the software. I haven't used it much myself, so I'm still kind of playing with and figuring out all the actual functionality. But on here you can see you've actually got a moving graph which actually maps data, and you can obviously record and save data on here. This both gives you voltage, current and power, or reading from the actual voltmeter itself. You can either set the settings via the kind of mouse. As you can see, I can actually use the mouse pointer and roll the hand around and then release it for both the voltage and the current. Or I can kind of go enter in the screen down on this side over here. I can go in, enter values for either the voltage or the current if I actually want to measure, input something fairly precise over here. You can see it's actually saying at the moment that I've got PC control, so the panel at the moment is locked. I can switch it to the panel. Remote measurement is obviously the remote sense to measure the voltage remotely. If I go and flick the output on, I'll just pull up the actual LEDs, so you can see I've got the LEDs over here. If I go and dial up the voltage, you can see the LEDs come on, and you can actually see the corresponding output over here on the graph. Now, something to note on here, you'll see that the voltage is actually only set to go up to 14 volts in the display here, and I've done that to protect while I'm using the mouse, so I don't go and set it to something ridiculous and actually blow the LEDs. Now, something to note, when you hold it, you can see it's green. It actually doesn't change the actual setting until I let go of the mouse button. Then it goes and makes a change. So just be wary of that. You can also use the mouse scroll button. So as you can see there, the find changes, and by default it changes the most significant digit. So that you've got to be wary of. I've gone in the settings, and I'll just show you that. If I go into configuration, you can go set what your arrow pointer, your page, your mouse wheel setting. You can see I've got it set over here to set just 0.1 of a volt. I've set the maximum to the 14 volts, hence why I've got it set there. So you can go and configure that, but just be aware of that. So if I make the changes here now with the mouse pointer and I drive the mouse wheel up, you can see how I can make adjustments and manually make changes over here. But obviously you just need to be careful, because if you do go wild and you haven't got the right settings here, you could blow something quite easily. Then also, so it's really handy that you're getting all these recordings in terms of voltage and current and power. But on the other side over here, you can go and program the actual device to go and step through certain steps and do things at a certain time. So you can go and set a certain voltage and a current and the time that it's got to set it for. So for instance, I could perhaps want to have a pre-program set up for a custom battery charge. I can go and set a voltage and a current and how long it's got to do it for, and then after that time it's going to go through the next step and the next step and the next step. You've also got something here called auto test, and I haven't really played with this, but from what I understand, you can go and obviously go and set certain voltages and currents, and actually it'll make measurements, and you can define limits for whether it's a pass or fail situation, and then it'll note the pass and fail over here. So there certainly seems to be a fair bit of functionality in the software, but as I say, I'm still actually learning to play with it myself. Right then, so I hope you found that of value. There are quite a few more things that could be shown on that power supply in terms of perhaps putting it on an oscilloscope under heavy load, seeing how what the switch on times are like on the electronic DC load in terms of perhaps hammering it with some high switch on and switch offs. And a bit more about the software, because I need to spend a bit more time with the software. If you are keen to see a part two, then certainly mention that, and in the future I'll try and put a part two out. It seems like a great meter. I'd certainly say that obviously where it talks about a 5.5-digit DVM, I'd question that. I think they're perhaps referring to the resolution of what it can show on the current. So that might be a little bit misleading. Just be aware of that. As I said, if I find I've made a mistake anywhere, I'll annotate, or if someone points out and says, no, this is how you get it to 5.5 digits, then fine. But anyway, thanks again to Frankie. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.